Hello, I'm Debbie Bell Hosking here at the Finextra TV virtual studio, and I'm joined by Yaela Shamberg of InvestCloud. We're chatting 2023 digital tools and trends. Yaela, lovely to have you with us.
Thank you for having me. It's really nice to be here.
So we're chatting about 2023 digital tools and trends. And it is a challenging time for the wealth industry as market volatility and inflation look set to continue. In your opinion, what digital tools can advisors use to guide investors through these times?
Well, I think what we're seeing with the volatility is really uncertainty, right? So there's the volatility, which make people nervous, but it's the uncertainty that most seems to be affecting decisions that people are making or not making. And so what we're seeing from our clients and our clients' clients is really taking a step back and focusing more on holistic advice and the holistic relationship rather than what do investments do during this time? Because as you said, there is volatility, but there's also a lot of uncertainty. So rather than say this is the prescriptive method we should take during this time, people don't actually know because the cycle looks a little bit different than previous formulas would have said and previous patterns more so. And so with that uncertainty, again, it's centered a little bit more on the individual, the holistic advice. And so people are now looking for tools to help them deliver that advice and connect with the end user or the end client in this case, and help to temper some of that uncertainty. Say all of this uncertainty is happening, but we're giving you this advice. It's about you. It's about what you need. And here's the tools that you can visit at any time. You can tinker with it or play with it as you need. Maybe it's a financial plan where you can like look at some scenarios. Maybe it's just visiting all of your accounts and your total net worth. So when the market moves, you look and you think, it actually isn't so bad for me. What do I look like given these uncertain times? And so we're seeing, again, these personalized and highly leverageable digital tools as being a really important piece now as advisors and wealth managers want to start being able to provide a little more reassurance and a little more communication to clients. And clients are used to communications on their timeline as well. So as we've all seen over the past 3 years, meetings aren't happening as much in person. You know, 3 years ago, Debbie, you and I would be together in a room, we'd be having a ball, but like we'd be together. Well, now this brings a different opportunity where we can have this conversation, but virtually. And so that obviously is translated to every industry and especially the wealth, which was very person to person because it's a very emotional experience for people. And so those digital tools that really help help strengthen the communication, strengthen the trust between an advisory relationship and a client relationship and make people feel like they have optionality. They can visit things and communicate in their time frame and on their device, on their phone, on their laptop. You know, whatever it is, that it's not just about a person-to-person meeting as maybe it used to be once or twice a year. And so we're seeing that be a big factor in what's driving decisions and what's driving behavior is, again, trying to really give people the tools that they need, both on the advice side and on the consumption or the client side. But then on top of that personalization I mentioned, I think what's really important is the idea of understanding behavioral science, understanding human behavior in why they're feeling the way they're feeling and what are the tools they need. And what we're seeing is if your digital tools provide you enough flexibility to have a persona or digital empathy, as we call it, digital empathy with you as the end user, meaning, you know, not only does it have your data, but maybe it has some educational material or some news and some content that really speaks to you and what you want and what you're concerned about, or just what's on your mind or what stage of life you're in, right? That digital empathy, again, makes it a more trusted relationships, kind of strengthen things. And that behavioral science really speaks to all of us as a human. So when you can bring the human element out in a digital experience by empathy, by behavioral science, by garnering good communication and giving optionality, I think that's the digital tool set that people are really looking through right now. As it pertains to managing their clients and helping them through these times of uncertainty.
Mm-hmm. And you're talking about where people are now And that word that kept cropping up in your response just now was the word advice. So when it comes to digital advice, what do you see as the next phase of digitalization? Is it a shift towards more sophisticated financial planning software, perhaps?
That's a good question. I would say that on a couple fronts. One, I think in terms of delivering advice, continuing on with that thread of personalization, I'll probably break this into three pieces. But one is people are looking for personalization in their investments, right? We see in younger generations, it's very value driven. Right? You're a value-driven investor. It matters to you where your money goes and then the impact, right? So it's value and impact and things that traditionally haven't always been on offer for individuals or certainly not mainstream individuals. Maybe it's been on offer because you can have a very specific personalized tailored portfolio that's kind of a one-off because you're an ultra high net worth individual and you have the right service level. But what we're seeing is that digital advice now needs to be more readily available at various wealth levels and emerging wealth levels. And it needs to, again, kind of have that digital empathy, but they need then, that means the advisors and the wealth managers need the tools to be able to deliver that at scale. So one, they need to be able to collect and understand their clients, understand that information. Two, they need to be able to deliver that personalized experience. So in the US, how that reflects a lot is understanding your specific tax scenario, because our tax code is complex and interesting, right? So being able to understand your personal tax scenario can really help change the outcome of what some of your investment opportunities are or where some of your dollars are best invested. And obviously internationally, there's a lot of that at play as well. So personalization, being able to understand how to deliver something that is meaningful on an investment horizon to someone, and then being able to continue to manage that in a scalable way, I think is where we see tools in terms of the actual like investment opportunities on the digital advice side. Now, you take that back to what I was saying before, and Debbie, you bring up a good point about like planning and advice. And so you think about holistic advice, and I think about who I am as a person and my values and my goals. I'm not just thinking about account balances and individual investments. I'm thinking about myself as an entire household and individual. And so my managers, my wealth managers are trying to meet me there. And I think by leveraging, again, digital tools and technology, especially around the planning area, is where you can start to bring that connection and that empathy I talked about a little bit with regards to your first question, which is I want to see a financial plan that reflects my values and my goals. It's not just here's retirement and here's what retirement looks for you. I might have a different scenario, you know, as a co-founder of a financial technology company, or I might have different values and goals of what I'm looking to do. And I want to see that reflected so that I feel that my wealth management team understand me and are working towards my specific goals. And I think being able to capture financial planning digitally is something that firms have traditionally struggled with. And it's been like on a piece of paper. And so you get a piece of paper once a year and you sit down and it just doesn't resonate with people in these days, where you think about being able to leverage digital tools for that and not only being able to help me formulate maybe a pretty simple plan, because maybe I don't know yet and I'm not ready to sit down and do a really robust, complex plan with my advisor. So get me involved in a digital way where we can kind of do it together, or you can invite me to put in some information, or I can start playing around. I think I used the word tinkering earlier, tinkering with some goals and see what that is. So where maybe I can start with a plan and still have the gratification and the engagement of having had a simple plan. And then when I'm ready or the advisory team's ready to start migrating me into what might be a complex cash flow planning, tax, estate, whatnot, or it might be in 10 years time when I need that type of complex planning. But so being able to understand where clients are along the wealth continuum, and then having a digital platform, especially around planning, that can help facilitate those conversations at different points along this person's life or along their wealth accumulation or decumulation phase is a really important factor. And I think we've seen the industry kind of fall short of providing that optionality in the past. So when I look forward and I look ahead, I see that being increasingly, not only increasingly important, but more optionality for advisors and clients and more optionality for where they are in their planning cycle and the level of sophistication needed, but then in the interaction with the tools as well.
So you talk about advisors and clients. Now, the wealth management is a market that is tipped to double in size. So what would you say wealth managers, how can they achieve growth and operational efficiency against a backdrop of increasing fee compression and competition?
What we've seen is, I think a couple of trends I mentioned earlier, the personalization in terms of attracting and retaining capital investment. But what you're also seeing is, interestingly enough, both banks and wealth managers really starting to merge into one space or come together. And so you have wealth managers and investment advisors who are looking to be able to offer more to their client. Again, speaking along that holistic advice. And so where they're trying to go, and when we're helping them get there, is how do they have a more robust product offering, banking, mortgages, you know, collateralized lending, things that are meaningfully different or meaningful tools to individuals' life. And so if you're just managing, you know, their goals via a small selection of their investments, it doesn't really speak to being able to offer holistic advice and being able to really be their key provider. And so we see those products really having increasing importance, I think, to individuals and to wealth managers so that they can offer that full holistic tool set for their clients. Not only that the clients can then log into a very heavily branded, beautifully designed client portal for that advisor, and being able to see everything together and access everything instead of having to go to a custodian, having to go to a different bank, having to go to this page, having to look at this. So really kind of bringing that together, I think, is a trend that will continue in 2023 and beyond as people look to aggregate what is right now a really disseminated kind of like data set for people. And what you also see then is you see banks looking to work more in the wealth space. And so some of them have clients that they would consider to be emerging wealth, right? Or Henry's, high earners, not rich yet, designated clients. And so what they want to do is they want to start capturing those. Not only they might have their bank balances, but how do they start to cultivate an investment or a wealth advisory relationship with them? And so again, how do they offer the right type of communication, the right type of digital engagement, and the tool set that now suddenly they were a bank, but they need to start thinking about planning and what is their planning tools. And as you said, like, it's looking to grow. There's a lot of money, and it's not only that, it's changing in who holds that money and who the decision makers are. We know, you know, there are billions and billions of dollars that are, if you look across the handful of years, are now in the hands of women who are making household decisions. That was not the case 10 years ago. And I think almost half of the households in the US are now the primary decision makers in the financial arena is the head of household is a woman. And so things like that are also playing into how banks and how wealth advisors are not only seeing their growth, but their prospective client base, and then trying to connect with them. And so we talked about personalization of investments. We talked about, value driven. And for a while, I think it was ESG, and now it's a little bit more impact investing and things like that. But now it's also, how do you offer something that is meaningful to the entire household? Like I said, a full set of services, and bring that all together. And we see those lines kind of blurring as to how they're playing together. We also, I look down the road and I see some really great collaborations and partnerships that are in the works too, so that all areas of the industry can continue to be their specialist and to profit, but at the same time, provide their key services to maybe the same client base, but more collaboratively rather than competitively, or having people, again, feel like it's two unique relationships, two different data sets, two places to go. And so I think we're going to see more merging of that and more more collaboration in that space, and a little bit more lines being blurred about who's offering what.
And it's interesting because you're talking about 2023 and beyond. So as we bring this interview to a close, Yaela, if we were to look in your crystal ball, how do you see technology and data analytics helping to reshape the industry?
It's an important one. And I think when we've all been thinking of for years, and every year it might look a little different, or every few years, maybe when we look ahead, I know we're all hopeful this is the year the data tells us everything we want to know. But I see the progress we've made over the years and where we're going with that. And it does, as a product person, it really excites me to see that technologically, we are starting to not only all value data, but starting to understand it better and organize and catalog. Because traditionally people had a whole bunch of data and they like threw it in a data lake or a data mart or whatever, but it doesn't mean they could do anything with it. And so we just took a different approach here to InvestCloud with a really structured and really robust digital warehouse where the data comes into. So what we're seeing now is the benefit of that, of having all this data well cataloged and normalized in one robust data set. And now we can start to understand. And so I think that's going to continue. Other people are going to not only catch on, have been working towards that. It's usually a pretty hefty investment and takes time, but they're starting to pull that together. And what I think it's going to tell us is actually, what are the buying patterns of advisors and individuals? Because we've seen technology help provide that information along the consumer sector, in how you can go to Amazon and you can open a store, and then there's all these analytics that the sellers can see who clicked here, and you get pinged, something's in your cart, do you want to come back for it, things like that. So we've seen that in our consumer lives, but our financial lives have been so far behind. And not only that, advisors, asset managers who are making products have been a little bit stabbing in the dark. I mean, they're experts, but at the same time, they don't know what other people are necessarily thinking. They're not psychic. And so what I'm excited about is the data now, I think, will start to show. And as we have here at InvestCloud, we have a financial supermarket, which I'm super excited about, because what that means is advisors can come on here in the U.S., kind of registered investment advisors can also come on, home offices can come on the financial supermarket and start to look through products, whether it's models and SMAs or ETFs or securities or insurance products, or, you know, like bringing that all together in a place where they can look and they can start to consume content much more aligned with how they're used to in their consumer lives, whether it's a video about it, whether it's a podcast, maybe it's this interview because it's going to be great, right? And so maybe that's posted there, but how do you consume content and media that helps you make decisions that are right for you, your business, and your clients? And so I think data and technology is doing more facilitation of that in the financial sector as we look forward this year, next year, and I think 2025 as well will be a really great year for that, where we'll see more of kind of a culmination and a comfort of that, of people adopting that. And what that means is you have less friction in the marketplace. And when there's less friction, that means there's, you know, more businesses happening and it's better for everyone. Things can happen faster, there's more operational efficiency, there's more client growth, but removing that friction means being able to use technology to go in to find the right type of opportunities for yourself, for your client, for your business, being able to do what we call kind of digital due diligence, but get the information you need in order to make a good decision, consume that information, and then interact, whether it's contractually, whether it's, you know, just in terms of communication, but really like find the right product and then being able to legally bring it into your portfolio or your portfolios for your clients. And so I see digital tools and technology massively helping remove what is a really riddled experience right now for asset managers and advisors. It's a very time-consuming process, and it's changed. It's helped to shape how our industry looks and what type of products people get availability to, based on the technology that the advisor uses. And it should be, what's the right product for you, regardless of technology platform or digital experience? You know, what is the right investment profile for you? But it's been hampered by technology. And so I see that being lifted. And what that also means is an opening for other types of assets, right? Participation in private assets for individuals, not just the ultra high net worth participation. And I mean, we saw a little bit of a fancy blurb with crypto and how people wanted to be involved with that and giving them the option, but structured products, alternatives, like I said, private assets, insurance products, things like that, where I think demystifying it a little bit and bringing it together. And I think technology can really, really play a massive part in that. And honestly, what's overdue for the end consumer where appropriate, and technology and the digital experience can start to give people an opportunity to engage with that.
Yaela, thank you. Because, you know, just looking forward, it's just more technology, but more help and less friction.
I think so.
Yaela, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you so much for having me, Debbie.